just from batch to batch, you'll see variances, but within the same batch, you'll see variances.
Another challenge for me, though, is like back in the day when we were unregulated and we had relationships with growers and we got it directly, we would buy potentially a pound and a half, maybe two if it was something very desirable. And then you would have that on hand for a nice run. And then just when you were running out, the harvest was coming down and you could replace it. And it was a pretty tight little system. And now I'll buy something 1 week and it's out of stock and I can't get it back from the distribution channel. So I'm thinking, this is interesting. Like the consistency of access is now not as consistent. And oddly, the distributor who is also a retailer, they will have stock that they need. So I'm not really feeling the love at this point.
It's a big challenge.
Keeping all of the private retailers stocked. And that is a big one. That's a big challenge. And I respect what the LDB is doing. I mean, I know that they're doing a lot of work and they've got a big learning curve in terms of storage and distribution and retailing themselves. But I feel like it was probably not a wise idea to have a distribution channel that is also a retailer right out of the gate.
How it affects consumers is that when you go from shop to shop, you're going to see a lot of the same products. Mm-hmm. Retailers who understand cannabis are going to quickly navigate their way through the selection of flowers at the LDB and figure out what people want. And then there's going to be a lot of competition for just those products. And so the challenges that we're facing, like Andrea said, is that, you know, we'll try something, find that it works, go back to get more, and it's gone. One of the things that's an underlying challenge here, you know, the LDB recently put a limit on orders, $350,000 per week. So that's a massive amount of product. And most small retailers can't afford that. But what we suspect is that there are big retailers who are aware of what the desirable products are, and they are maxing out their orders and basically getting monopoly positions on products. So we have a monopoly retailer that chooses what products we get to select, and then they don't have any checks and balances. They have a $350,000 cap when they're distributing to retailers.
Per week.
So if I'm a publicly traded retailer and I have 20 shops across the country and I have three in Vancouver, or in BC, well, I can go ahead and buy all of the Broken Coast products, all of the Whistler Organic, or all of the Quest, or whatever, and leave the smaller retailers wondering where all the quality products are. So it's...
Well, and here's another layer. There isn't a manufacturer-suggested retail price. So in any other commodity, there's an MSRP. And if I produce this, I want it to be sold at X dollars. That's the general.
To protect your brand integrity. Right?
But that's not how it is here. It's basically you mark it up as much as you want to mark it up. So you may have some people who say, I've got a long run. I've got tons of money. I don't need to make money for the next 5 years. I'm going to sell it at $1 above cost. And then you may have other people who say, I've got a tiny business with a lot of, I've got to mark this at 200%. Like, there's no rhyme or reason for the pricing. So the consumer may walk into one store and say, oh, look, here's X brand's this product and it costs this much. I love it. Oh, there's another shop. I'm going to go there. Wait, why is it so much cheaper? Or why is it so much more expensive? That doesn't create any kind of brand loyalty or integrity either. So it's a bit of the Wild West still. And that's unsettling for me.
So back to how this affects consumers, it means that they don't have the confidence that their favorite retailer will have their favorite product when they want to go shop. Mm-hmm. They don't have the same selection that they might have had under the pre-regulation days. Mm-hmm. You know, same product, same in different stores. And, you know, I think ultimately for the consumer, they're losing out. You know, one of the great things about the era that we left, which I like to call the golden age of cannabis access. One of the great things was you could have a small batch producer in, you know, Powell River on the Sunshine Coast. And they can give you a beautiful exotic flower that was only at your shop. And you could have it tested. You could make sure that it was cleanly grown. And you had something that was unique and that differentiated your shop. And that could create that brand loyalty that, you know, many consumers want to give to their favorite retailer. So that potential has been eroded away.
There's also people who are like ourselves. Like, there are people who are in this industry who want to focus and rely on data collecting, and that data collecting will transfer back to the producers, and then they will start to refine their processes, and that, if that is comfortable for you, that's great. There are lots of apps you can subscribe to, and you can start giving people all of your information. But I'm somewhat leery of that for a number of different reasons. I don't want to collect their data, basically. I want people to encourage people to journal and to discuss with people and to go analog with their experience, right? That may be a bit romantic. I don't know. But that's how I feel, and that's how we're operating at the village currently, that we're going to do our own analysis. And of course, there is some data collected in terms of raw purchase data, but it's not assigned to an individual person or their particular likes and dislikes.
You can't actually collect personal data anymore.
Yeah, you're right. But there are workarounds with apps that tie into your POS systems that identify who you are, what your demographic is, what your buying behaviors are. And I'm just not interested in collecting that. But I am interested in working with people to journal and to track what it is that you purchased, what you liked, what you didn't like. So that comes down to how do we select products. So we actually select products like a consumer might. We buy samples from the liquor distribution, so the BC Cannabis store, as a regular customer, because you're not allowed to get samples from anybody, so you have to buy them. And then you want to burn test them and smell them and feel them and do all the things that you would do to any other cannabis product that we might have done in the past. There are extra layers that we've added. We've done things like rehydrated product that was old and found that it actually does come back to life. And so, and some things are best baked versus best rolled. And we have established these kinds of nuances through our own trial and error. And that's basically what we have to do and encourage people to do themselves. Really, if you've heard that houseplant is exciting and they've got great social media and you come in and you ask for that, that's a baseline. You've had that experience. Now come back and talk about what that was like. And you want to know what the cultivar was. Well, it's actually a chem dog cultivar. And there are other makers of chem dog. And you could explore a number of chem dogs and see if you like them, if there's any difference between them. And that's how you will develop that brand loyalty long term. I do appreciate brands to sort of have something to run your comparison against. And just like growers back in the day, there were growers that people loved and growers that people just like, didn't remember, you know? So that's kind of what's going on currently. It's all about exploring, discussing, journaling, and going back out there. So
yeah, I think that, you know, if we're going to take this back to the consumers, or, you know, mm-hmm. just continuing to talk about the consumers, mm-hmm. picking products has traditionally been about smelling and then buying a small sample and then trying it for yourself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you can still get smell jars. You can still have smell samples. They might not tell you as much as the old school, you know, 1 ounce smell sample. Now it's like a gram smell sample, right? So I think that one of the tactics that many consumers are using to help pick their products is online research. Sure. You know, Leafly is now rating cannabis products. Reddit has a huge spread on regulated cannabis flowers. Mm-hmm. Lyft does their own rating system. And this is another one that Unity mentioned that I don't remember, but it was actually the best. Remember, it was had an interesting name, Strawberry something, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But he had like 1,200 tests.
And
Pancake Nap.
A blogger, really great resource.
Best
I don't know
review.
If there's a woman, to be honest. We shouldn't say he, we should say they.
Okay. I didn't think I said he, but the recording will tell us. But no, I think that, you know, using the internet to research the licensed producers will give you a baseline. So when you walk into a store, you got a feel for the lay of the land. You know what brands you might be looking for. You have an idea of what cultivars of theirs might have gotten the better reviews. And then you don't have to start from zero like we were doing when we were sampling and getting our first order together.
What is interesting, though, is you will find a lot more drama around those people who have had bad runs, like if they had a crop fail or if they got powdery mildew. And it's like, it's interesting because the producers now are so, under such a lens, and they have to be accountable. And if something goes wrong, it goes wrong. Back in the day, I think if you lost a crop, you just didn't tell anybody. So that, you know, you didn't have to run with that. Or you did.
You know, like we would be like, hey, where's the Congo? Sorry, I lost that crop.
Yeah.
You know, it's a difficult plant to grow or whatever. Like, you know, we had a better dialogue with our growers.
choice.
And this too, the people that we work with, but I don't know, there's tons of people that we don't know. They might not have ever said anything. And now if you've had one bad run and the news finds out about it, they're going to grind you and grind you and grind you. So I have a bit of empathy for them on some level. It's a challenging plant to grow.
And your last question, how different is your customer service approach in the new regulated market?
How different is it? It's not that different, to be honest. We have not changed much at all. It's still very much about giving as much information as we've been able to garner. We've gone above and beyond to find out how this is growing, why did you grow it, where was it growing, what's the maiden name, because a lot of them come in with this new fancy word, like, you know, relax.
Utopia.
Okay, utopia. Yeah. And if we can find out what the maiden name of the plant is, and that's, you know, its original, whatever it was, a Girl Scout, who knows. Yeah, we take all of our experience and share it and then invite them to explore it themselves and come back. So it's very similar as it was.
Nobody's going Girl Scout in the bigger.
I don't think you're allowed to use Girl Scout. You can't use that word anymore. So it might be out there. We'll see.
Well, yeah, I think that's exactly where I was going to go with this. You know, our customer service approach hasn't changed. If anything, it's nuanced. It's like a bigger focus on the nuances. You can't say, if someone comes in and says, hey, I'm in a lot of pain, what do you have for pain? You can't say, oh, try that product. It's more like, these types of products have worked for pain for some people, you know, and then you can show them the products. But you just have to qualify everything in that it's not a guarantee. It's not necessarily going to work for you. It might have worked for them, but that doesn't mean it'll work for your difference. And it's still about inviting people to explore and try new things and engage. Affordability can become more of an issue in this market, but that's a matter of time and more producers entering the market, more products being available, and you know, the prices will come down as supply increases.
And I'm really grateful to have had 4 years of unregulated market experience where we've developed really good, solid relationships with consumers. And there is a trust that allows us to transfer over to this side. And we're using those relationships to help establish a more robust market in BC by including them in our feedback loop. So we have a little card that says, the more we get together, the happier we'll be. And on that card, we have our email, and we also have the customer service for the BC Cannabis
branch.
And with that feedback, with that card, we invite people to give us their feedback. If it's packaging, I get it. Let's talk about that. If it's something you really love, to share that. That helps us. If it's something you're really disappointed with, let's see how we can work around that. A lot of the time it's that it was very dry, and that's just a simple rehydration. And it really is a game changer. But yeah, we want to be part of that positive feedback loop. I get it. It's different. We have been set back. There are some challenges. But people are listening. And there are more retailers now than, you know, more regulated retailers now than we had, you know, 3 months ago. So it's changing and it's growing. And we're now a voice of regulated retailers who may share similar challenges. And that will help us to put pressure on the people who have the power to make those changes. And that's inspiring. So I want to end this up with, we have an annual general meeting with our trade association, ACRES. And I'm super excited about that because I feel like this is going to be the first time that a lot of us who have been regulated and are over that initial hurdle can come together as a unified voice and start exploring what it is that we want to see moving forward so that we can advocate better for our customers.
And I'll just end with, you know, our journey from when we opened our shop to becoming regulated was full of work and political activity and, you know, getting on our soapbox and putting ourselves out there and really, really advocating for change and for something better for Canadians. So now we're here and it's very clear that the job is not done. The work that we did to get here has to be continued with the same intensity, if not more, because I think that in the regulated world, there are going to be more people who understand political engagement and political action and more people who are willing to really get behind this. And that's my real hope, because we're, you know, like she said, we're just at the verge of our first AGM with ACRES. in the regulated world. And we have some great producers who will be there. There's going to be a lot of retailers there. It's going to be the start of something big.
And it's nice